You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, and welcome to Criminal Justice Administration 446, Terrorism and Extremism. I'm Professor Gus Martin, and this is our first installment of what promises to be a very good session on learning almost everything you always want to know about terrorism and extremism. At the outset, I just want to mention that this course will be unlike any other that you've taken, perhaps, for the reason that there's always something new happening. Whether that's good or bad, this tends to be a very dynamic subject. And it is also very multidisciplinary. So during the course of this semester, you are going to become sociologists, political scientists, psychologists, historians. It's very multidisciplinary, and I might add, very, very interesting. So welcome to Terrorism and Extremism. We are going to discover that this is a very interesting subject, and it can be complicated at times, mainly because it involves a lot of policy considerations, a great deal of politics, and a great deal of history. We will combine the realms of ideas and events, and you will find that this course is almost exclusively about ideas and events. And what I mean by that is, in order to understand terrorism, we have to understand extremism. In other words, ideas. Terrorism involves any number of events, clearly, but we have to look at the why of those events. So just by way of introduction, let me introduce who I am. Professor Gus Martin. I was an attorney by trade for a number of years. My first job was working for a member of Congress for several years, and I also worked in-house as in-house counsel for the American Psychological Association. I was a special counsel to the Attorney General of the United States Virgin Islands. And when I went back to graduate school to earn my PhD, I was also in-house counsel to the Fair Housing Partnership, in which we investigated housing discrimination. My degree, my PhD, is from University of Pittsburgh, and I taught there for 2 years before coming to California State University, Dominguez Hills. I joined the faculty at Dominguez Hills in January of 2001, and I spent about nearly 10 years in academic administration, first as an associate vice president for faculty affairs, and then the associate vice president for human resources management. I'm now a full-time, full professor at Criminal Justice Administration, and I encourage you to get in touch with me if you have any questions about this field, because it is fascinating. So my special interests are criminal justice administration, security policy, youth issues such as gangs, delinquency, etc., and especially the why of terrorism. In other words, extremism, looking at the motivations, the motives behind terrorist violence. So this particular introductory meeting is going to be about the nuts and bolts of the course. You will acquire a good understanding of terrorism and the nature of extremist ideologies. The course material in general, the ideas portion, that is the why of all of this, has a moderate level of complexity. We have lots of examples of groups that espouse these ideas. We certainly will look at religion, but we'll also look at fascism, Marxism, racism, and other justifications for extremist violence or terrorism. I'd like to show you very quickly Blackboard, because this is, as you know, a televised online course. So let me take you to our Blackboard website and just introduce you to our Blackboard content and our website. Firstly, occasionally there will be announcements, but this is actually a summary of the course, which you will see on Blackboard. You notice it has a DHTV website, the YouTube channel, where these lectures, televised lectures, will be posted. And you will see other information that is also contained in the syllabus. We'll go through the syllabus in a moment, but I just want to orient you firstly with the content of Blackboard. Then my contact information is located here. As you can see, office hours are Mondays from 2 until 4 o'clock or by appointment. This also has my direct phone number and also the address of where I am located. The syllabus is located at this link, which we'll come back to in just a moment. There will be quizzes, a total of 7 quizzes. These will only be available to you within a 24-hour window, and you have 24 hours to complete these quizzes. There will also be discussion activities. These will be available within a one-week window, so you won't see them now, but you will see them when they become due. And you will see, you should select one of the indicated chapters threaded discussions to post your answer and discussion. You should comment on at least 2 posts from other students prior to posting your particular discussion. You will also see on here links for your research paper assignments. There will be a topic that's due on March 4th, an outline that's due on March 25th, and a research paper that's due on May 13th. So basically, these are the nuts and bolts of our Blackboard link. Now, let us come back to the syllabus and let me introduce you to the course. You can certainly download the syllabus, or you can read it online. As you can see, it has the course information, that is my contact information, and also the broadcast information at the top of the syllabus. The live broadcast will be from 1 o'clock until 3 o'clock on Wednesdays. And then streamed broadcast will occur after that on Wednesdays from 3 to 5. And there will be archived broadcasts on YouTube, the CSUDH YouTube channel. The live broadcast can be viewed at these particular broadcast stations. And again, all of this is in the syllabus. The streamed lectures can be viewed at the DHTV website at this particular link. And again, you can access the link directly from Blackboard. Archived lectures will also be accessible from Blackboard. Learning goals and objectives you will find posted here also. The book is a book that I wrote, actually. It's called Understanding Terrorism, the 6th Edition. You should purchase or access the 6th edition because it is the most recent, the most updated edition of Understanding Terrorism. And there's a student study site, which we will come back to in a moment. The student study site is very, very good, actually. And it has a lot of information about how to succeed in this course. For the evaluation, the discussion activities, there will be 5 graded discussion activities. Each one, as you can see, is worth 6% of your overall grade for a total of 30% of your overall grade. There will be 7 bi-weekly quizzes. They will be true, false, and multiple choice. And you will answer the questions online and then receive your feedback immediately after you are finished with the quiz. Each quiz is worth 7% for a total of 49% of your grade. And then, finally, a research paper, a 7-page research paper is due that counts for 21% of your grade. You should use the American Psychological Association reference style. And please remember that your research paper is 7 pages of discussion. The cover page, the list of citations does not count toward the discussion. And just general policies about computing and others. Academic integrity and plagiarism, please read this thoroughly. We are using, you're going to upload every assignment on Turnitin. Turn it in does not mean you're simply turning in your assignment. It checks for plagiarism. And you can see it will immediately give you feedback about originality. And any report that comes back with originality is higher than 20% may be considered plagiarism. So please read this and be very mindful about this. Professional comportment. Basically, we will be civil in this class. And if anyone requires an accommodation, that will be provided. So contact the Student Disability Resource Center, and the link to that can be accessed through Blackboard through the syllabus. So if anyone requires an accommodation, it will be provided. Now, let's explore what we're going to study in this course. Firstly, today is Terrorism First Impressions, beginning with Chapter 1. And then next week, the second sessions will be on defining terrorism and extremism. When we talk about defining terrorism and extremism, one has to understand that there are many definitions. And we have to be disciplined in how we define terrorism and disciplined in how we define extremism. After that, we will look at the causes of terrorism and extremism. There are many justifications for extremist violence. We will look at the roots of terrorism and extremism and study a variety of concepts explaining this. The quiz, first quiz will be for chapters 1 and 2, and they will be due on February 5th. Then the following week, the first discussion activity will be due, chapters 1, 2, and 3, and we will look at terrorism from above or state terrorism. Keep in mind that many more people have been killed through violence by governments than by these terrorist organizations. So our first typology will be what governments have done that we can define as terrorism. And then we will look at dissident terrorism. That is terror from below, meaning the terrorist organizations. And quiz number 2 will be due on that day. Again, there will be a 24-hour window for that. And the following week, there will be a one-week window to complete the discussion activity number 2. And the next typology, though, we will look at will be terrorism in the name of religious faith. In other words, how people of faith justify extreme violence, why they do that. It is at high tide in the current era. On 4th of March, you'll see that the third quiz is due, but also research paper topics should be uploaded on Blackboard via Turnitin. So think about your topic for your paper beginning now, and it can be changed, that's fine, but just let me know. Advise me what you would like to write about, and if you have to change it later in the semester, let me know. The next typology, though, that we'll look at is violent ideologies. Here we are going to discuss concepts such as anarchism, Marxism, fascism, and other kinds of extremist ideologies. The next typology will be international terrorism on the 11th of March, and discussion activity number 3 will be due on that date also. International terrorism, by the way, involves when the revolution crosses state borders and is fought on the global battlefield. We will then look at controversial concepts. This concept of emerging terrorist environments, we will look at 2 of them. It's what I have termed gender selective terrorism and criminal dissident terrorism. This will be explained later, but just understand that these are emerging concepts in the world. Part 3, we will look at the terrorist trade and counterterrorism. And on 25th of March, your research paper outlines are due. The tools of the trade, tactics and targets of terrorists will be discussed. In other words, what they do and how they do it. We will have spring break on April 1st. And then on April 8th, we will look at the role of the media. In other words, we will have already discussed how certain elements such as chemicals, biological agents can be weaponized. Here, we will look at how propaganda how information can be weaponized. Then we will discuss the case study of the United States. This is a simple case study. We could look at other case studies, but this one is in particular is one that we are familiar with. And then we will look at how we respond to counterterrorism. This concept of homeland security and counterterrorism is very critical to understand, primarily because when we look at solutions, understand that it is a complex problem that we have. Anyone who gives us a simple solution to this complex problem is not telling us the truth. This is a complicated response to a complicated problem. And then finally, the future of terrorism. Research papers are due on the 13th of May. Now, just to explain the research paper, it must contain 7 pages of discussion and analysis. The cover page and works cited do not count toward the page requirement. So please keep that in mind as you begin your research and as you complete the paper. You should use the American Psychological Association citation form. You can refer to their publication manual at the link that can be found here in the syllabus, and it can be accessed through Blackboard. So let me know if you have any difficulties with accessing this particular style, referencing style. You should have these particular sections: the introduction, issue identification, background, analysis, and conclusion. And this is the grading policy. So these are the translations. And A, and as you can see, is translated into numerical score and grade points. So if you have any questions about what grade you may see on your paper or on your discussion activities or anything along those lines, take a look at this. This will translate your grade. If extra credit is given, then it will be optional. You're not required to do it, but if you do, it will be a grade increaser, a grade enhancer. For grading criteria, you will see that the discussion activities, quizzes, and research paper percentages are all summarized here. This is how your grade will be calculated. And the student study site is also linked here. And then finally, the biographical profile. Please fill it out. Please send it to me either via email or drop it off at my office, and we can be introduced to each other. But this is strictly for my own information to get to know you more carefully. Now, so please contact me if you have any questions about either the syllabus or about the Blackboard website. And now let me take you to the study site. This link is very helpful, very useful for as you prepare for the exams, for the quizzes, the discussion activities, and your paper. So as you can see, every chapter from the textbook is listed here. If, for example, you click on Chapter 6, Religious Terrorism, you'll see there are practice quizzes, practice flashcards, stage study journal articles, recommended readings, and web resources. So everything you need for writing a paper or for preparing yourself is in here. I encourage you to access this site more than one time, and then let me know if you have any questions about it. So, by way of introduction, that is what we're going to look at. Now, let me just say this before we get to our lecture on Chapter 1 from the textbook. In general, the lectures and discussions and assignments expand upon the readings, so you must do the readings, but everything that we discuss will be following the textbook and also following the PowerPoint presentations. The PowerPoints will be posted every week, and they are a very good outline for the class. The class format is essentially lecture and question and answer style. So if you wish to discuss anything, if you have any questions, there is a call-in number that in which you can dial in live, and we can have a conversation about anything, about any questions that may come up. The number, as you can see, is on your screen, 310-928-7330. If you have a question after viewing some of the archived videos, then just contact me directly, and I'll answer your questions either via email or through telephone. In addition to that, if you want to send an email during one of the live presentations, there is a Gmail account that you can access, which you can see on the screen. It is basically askdhtvlive@gmail.com. So if you send in a question, it will be answered during this. Questions and discussion are encouraged because there is no such thing as a stupid question, trust me. Do not be shy, so feel free to contact me at any time during the course of the semester. In terms of atmosphere, I encourage openness. Your opinions are welcome, and I'm always available for questions, business, or just occasional shooting the breeze. Now, let us begin looking at terrorism and extremism, beginning with the conceptual review of terrorism. Just conceptually, I want you to understand that this is a critical thinking moment. Certainly this particular lecture, but also critical thinking throughout the course. You are encouraged to step back and evaluate events that we will discuss. And unfortunately, generally most semesters, something does occur in the world which we can discuss and we can evaluate. Which brings us to our first impressions. So it's critical thinking time. This idea of 9/11 has become a concept. 9/11, it is a symbol. It is no longer simply an event that happened. It is a symbol of events that changed our world, changed our behavior, our lifestyles. As we will see, simply going to the airport has been greatly affected by this concept, this symbol of 9/11. So this is a new era of terrorism. As you will see, there was a previous era prior to the current one, prior to this 9/11 symbolism. So the previous era, if anything, the terrorists were more selective in their targets. In the modern era, terrorists view entire populations as enemy populations, and high homicide counts is something that they seek. So that's why we see these massive attacks and these very high casualty rates in the modern era. The new terrorists view entire populations as being legitimate targets. Now, for first considerations, we will just review several things. We're going to look at an overview of terrorism and extremism, terrorism at first glance, and then sources of extremism and terrorism. So the question that I will have for you as we go through this is, what are the goals of terrorism? What outcomes do terrorists seek? They seek disruption, terror, and it is a form of low-intensity warfare from their perspective. Remember, just look at the word terrorism. It is a war in our heads to sow terror. So in what ways, you may ask, is terrorism useful? That's another question that you have to think critically about, because it is a useful tool for some individuals, for some movements. First of all, it has propaganda value. And you're wondering, what kind of value are we talking about, propaganda value? Well, it's simply, you should think of it in terms of propaganda by the deed, armed propaganda. In other words, they're not simply sending out news releases or standing on a street corner with a bullhorn. They are engaging in extreme violence, and even if we actually say that we successfully thwarted this violence, they will always claim victory. Any form of violence that garners attention of the world is a victory. It has propaganda value. And another thing that it is useful for is that it sometimes works. Sometimes the terrorists achieve their goals. Their demands may be met. For example, on March 11th, 2004 in Spain, terrorists attacked the transportation system in Madrid, the capital city of Spain. At that time, Spain had soldiers in Iraq assisting in our effort, in our occupation of Iraq. They immediately pulled out. Their government collapsed. It was a conservative government, and a socialist government took over in Spain, and they ended their involvement in the Iraq War. So those attacks, as violent and bloody as they were successful. Now, these concepts, I want you to remember these concepts of extremism and terrorism. Terrorism is a quality, we are defining it as a quality that is radical in opinion, especially political matters. It is ultra and advanced. It is something that it can be either on the fringes of society, out of the mainstream, or some societies become mainstream extremists. You can see by the salutes in the photograph on this particular slide. This is the fascist salute. And fascism took hold in a number of countries throughout history. So that means that the majority, the mainstream within those particular countries were extremists. And we must be warned about that because it can happen. It has happened, for example, in the United States. Terrorism, we can define as politically motivated violence, usually directed against soft targets, meaning passive targets, with an intention to affect or terrorize a target audience. So this is the thing to keep in mind as we, at first glance, that terrorism is political violence. It's directed against soft targets, and it is intended to affect a broader audience. So it has to be political against a soft target, intending to affect a target audience. So, terrorism. Remember that perpetrators, people who engage in what we call terrorism, claim to champion noble causes and values. They will always say that they are on the right side of history, that they are fighting for a good reason. The advocates cite righteous goals to justify their behavior. It could be being blessed by their religious faith, or fighting to liberate their people, or fighting to reassert the superiority of their race. So all these advocates will say that these are righteous goals. And perpetrators uniformly maintain that they are freedom fighters, or champions of law and social order. Now, the thing to keep in mind about this is that as you will see when we discuss the definitions of terrorism later, we'll spend a good deal of time talking about that. Very often it's a matter of perspective, so that if bombs are dropping on us, we will say the people who are doing that are terrorists. But if the bombs are going in the other direction in the name of our liberty, in the name of our freedom, we'll say the people who are engaging that violence are freedom fighters. So very often it's a matter of perspective, and this is just a terrorism at first glance. We'll explore that particular concept in much greater detail later. Now, the sources of terrorism and extremism. Terrorist acts are grounded in extremist beliefs arising from group identity, intergroup conflict, and a chosen strategy. So remember, terrorism are the events that are grounded in extremist beliefs. The extremist beliefs are the justifications, and they stem from any number of different sources. It is a subject of extensive discussion, debate, and research. During my research, I saw more than 100 definitions of terrorism, and there are certain basic baselines, but you know, there's extensive debate and discussion that's going on. And as I said before, it is multidisciplinary. It involves many disciplines, sociology, psychology, criminology, political science, and more. Engineering, believe it or not, and other sources of other kinds of disciplines are involved with this. Now, what I want to mention is this, that we are going to review some conceptual considerations involving political violence. We are going to review several things that involve the significance of symbolism, which is critical. This will return again and again throughout this semester. Political violence, whether it is mala prohibita or mala in se, those of us who are criminal justice scholars or students understand these terms, which we'll get to in a moment, but they are very applicable to understanding political violence. And then something called the just war doctrine, which is very ancient. It goes back to about the year 400 in the Christian era. Now, symbolism. The thing to take from this is that it is a central feature of extremism and terrorism. Every target represents a symbol. It is central to the terrorist public relations and propaganda campaigns. If we understand the symbol, then we understand their motivations. The targets symbolize the righteousness of the terrorist cause and the evil of their opponent. So terrorist attacks are not random. They symbolize something. They are not simply accidents. Every target symbolizes something that the terrorists are opposed to. And then, the concepts that are criminal justice concepts. First of all, the question is whether terrorist violence is mala prohibita or mala in se. And remember, mala in se acts are crimes that are made illegal by legislation. They're not inherently immoral, wicked, or evil. And there are a lot of cases about like that, you know, gambling, prostitution, and so forth, or some drug possession, marijuana possession. You know, the question is whether they are illegal simply because we say so, and they are not inherently immoral. Then there's mala in se. These are acts that are immoral or wrong in themselves. They cannot be justified in a civilized society and have no acceptable qualities. Crimes such as murder, rape, arson, and so forth. So the question here is whether terrorism is malum in se or malum prohibitum. We'll explore these. And then the final concept in understanding political violence is the just war doctrine. The just war. This was developed by actually Saint Augustine in about the 5th century AD. And it is an ideal and moralistic philosophy. The question is what are the justifications for engaging in warfare or in violence? So the first concept, it was called jus in bello. This is correct behavior while waging war. In other words, innocent targets should not be killed, for example. So correct behavior while waging war. It might also involve simply fighting between standing armies, not engaging in terrorism or guerrilla warfare. Then there is jus ad bellum. That is the correct conditions for waging war in the first place. This is often used conceptually by extremists to justify violence. What this refers to is justifications for violence, justifications for waging war. This is always a consideration when nations go to war or when people go to war. So let us proceed by exploring a historical perspective for looking at what we call terrorism, what we would refer to as extremism. If you have any questions, once again, please feel free to dial in at any time, or feel free to send an email at any time, and we will discuss whatever issue you would like to discuss. So So let us begin by looking at the past as prologue and historical perspectives on terrorism and also extremism. What is interesting is that we now freely accept that there is such a thing as terrorism, but understand that these behaviors have occurred throughout history. For example, in antiquity, and events or behaviors were acceptable at the time, and they were not referred to as being terroristic. That word did not exist. So in antiquity, in Greek democracies, in Greek society, killing tyrants was considered to be noble. Those who killed tyrants, in other words, dictators who were leading Greek city-states, those who killed them were sometimes glorified. They would build statues about them after they were executed, of course, but they would glorify what they had done by killing the tyrants. That is tyrannicide. Also in antiquity, we saw policies by empires and kingdoms of simply removing populations, mass exile, take them out of their homeland and move them to a far corner of the empire so that they would have no claim to their homeland. And we might call that ethnic cleansing in the modern era. Ethnic cleansing in the modern era is considered to be nothing short of genocide. But at that time, the mass exile policies were not uncommon. For example, the ancient Jewish people were exiled by the Babylonian Empire to the far corners of the empire. And then during the Roman age, the Romans were absolutely ruthless against those who opposed them. If a population accepted Roman conquest, then they were treated not so badly, actually. But there were policies of conquest that were absolutely ruthless. There are historical examples of Romans engaging in what we would call genocide. For example, some Germanic tribes were exterminated. Some Germanic tribes were exterminated to the extent that perhaps 100,000 or 400,000 people were simply killed. And then this particular method of execution called crucifixion was one that was intended to inflict maximum pain through torture, and it was intended to terrify anyone who would oppose Rome. Interestingly, crucifixion was used against rebels, against those who rebelled against Rome. So that what we have seen, or what we saw, was that crucifixion was not used against Roman citizens. Someone would be either nailed or tied to a cross, essentially, to a beam, and they were left to die. And that was considered to be a form of execution, a legitimate form of execution, intending to send a message to any potential would-be rebels. There was also the policy of regicide in determining who would become an emperor. Regicide simply refers to the king killing, the killing of kings. Romans, unfortunately, had no smooth way, no regular way to select a new emperor, so very often it was done simply through killing an emperor and installing a new one. And then there are the examples of the zealots and sicarii during the Roman age. We've all seen this word zealot or zealotry before. The zealots were a movement among the ancient Jewish populations in Palestine. They engaged in hit and run tactics, assassinations. They used a knife called a sicca, and so they became known as the sicarii. And when you listen, when you look at that word, sicario, that word is still being used among assassins in organized crime, the sicario. Well, it comes from this ancient zealot knife that was used to kill Romans and other people. So that form of warfare is what we might call terrorism in the modern age. Which brings us to the French Revolution, which is arguably the first true use of state terrorism and other forms of terrorism. And in fact, the word terrorism was coined during the French Revolution. It was used as a word that had no negative connotation. The French Revolution had a period from a one-year period from June of 1793 to July of 1794 called the Reign of Terror. The French revolutionaries used that word in a positive sense. They said they had to exterminate the opposition, exterminate the nobility, and they called the Reign of Terror as something wonderful, something beautiful. They used an instrument of execution called the guillotine, which beheaded people. The guillotine was considered to be merciful because it resulted in instantaneous death, so the revolutionaries considered themselves to be merciful people, even though they publicly executed between 17,000 and 40,000 people during the Reign of Terror. About 200,000 political prisoners died in prison during the French Revolution. So this was arguably the first extensive use of what we would call terror in the modern ideological era. Which brings us to the 19th century, which is really the foundation. It's the incubator for modern ideologies, the incubator for modern terrorism. 19th century Europe had several ideologies that are still very much active in the world. Anarchism, for example, and Marxism. We will come back to anarchism and Marxism in much greater detail. Just understand that they began as revolutionary ideologies in the 19th century, and they were very prominent during the 20th century, and they still are prominent, although to a lower degree, in the 21st century. The Luddites were a movement in the United Kingdom that we might consider to be modern-day anti-technology anarchists. The Luddites were also termed the machine breakers. They destroyed machinery in the new textile factories in the United Kingdom because they considered them to degrade human dignity, and also that they were destroying an old system of agrarian independence. And then, lastly, the last example is the people's will, so-called Narodnaya Volya in Russia. They were active in Tsarist Russia, and they were the first of the truly modern dissident terrorist movements. They were king killers. They were nobility killers. They engaged in assassination. But the interesting thing is, if anything, they could be considered to be moral or moralistic terrorists. They carefully selected their targets. They debated whether or not to use violence. The modern era that we live in does not have that. There are carefully debated targets, but they could be entire populations. During this era, the terrorists, the extremists, used the gun, the knife, and the bomb. What we see even in the 21st century, the weapons of choice, the baseline weapons for terrorism, are still the gun, the knife, and the bomb. So just keep in mind that what we see historically is the true unfolding of what we are still living through. And it's important to understand that because history does not begin with our generation. Terrorism does not begin with our generation. It began generations ago and arguably centuries ago. Now, the modern era, what we have is the so-called new terrorism. Keep this particular phrase in mind, this concept in mind. The new terrorism differs from what we just discussed. It is cell-based. They're willing to use weapons of mass destruction. Their ideologies are politically vague or religious. They use asymmetrical warfare, and they employ modern technologies. We will explore all of these, but just for now, understand that where we are talking about are independent cells or individuals, so-called lone wolves. Weapons of mass destruction could include the airliners, the jetliners that were used on 9/11. Politically vague ideologies or religious ideologies, the justifications, for example, that are religious, say that God will bless whatever level of violence these people engage in. And as you can see from the photograph on this particular slide, that is Islamic State. Islamic State is an idea. We tend to think of Islamic State as simply being a geographic area or entity, but it is a concept, as is Al-Qaeda. Asymmetrical warfare means that they will attack using means that one cannot predict, attacking targets that one cannot anticipate, and timing it in ways that one cannot anticipate. And the use of modern technologies include, of course, things as sophisticated as weapons of mass destruction, such as chemical weapons, or as unsophisticated as a knife, as a hatchet, which have been used, or as a motorized vehicle, which has been used. So the modern era is, if anything, more or less predictable. It is more deadly in the attacks that occur, and it shows no sense of no real current abatement period. In other words, it's not being reduced in terms of motivation or intensity. It will eventually, because all terrorist cycles end, but the modern era, the new terrorism, is still very much an active entity in the world. Now, one thing that we want to explore now is this concept of a lone wolf. Before we do that, we are going to take a short break. We are going to take a short break, then I'll come back and we'll conclude our discussion today by looking at this concept of the lone wolf, because the lone wolf phenomenon is one is truly symbolic of the modern era, and it has taken hold as a viable strategy and tactic among the violent extremists. So let's go to our break. We'll return and we will finish up by talking about the lone wolf phenomenon.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Yo, I feel like before I was just by myself. I'm not gonna get distracted by anything or anybody. I'm just here on a mission, that's what I thought. But I started to realize that I don't wanna be just a student, I wanna be like a motivation to somebody.
I love my job. I wanted to be able to have a place, like a laboratory on campus, that people could actually get hands-on into making a difference. The CSUDH Urban Farm is one part of the operation that we're building here. We have energy systems, we have food systems, we have transportation systems, and we're trying to make them more sustainable.
I started to volunteer a lot to just let myself get exposed to different things that I wasn't used to get out of that comfort zone.
One of the reasons I teach here is because my own artwork has a really strong tie to the LA community. There's some really amazing artists who live and work in South Los Angeles. They want to work with our students. And when they actually meet these artists, it's like very transformative. They start to realize that their time here at CSUDH isn't about finding something new to make art about. It's actually about how to shape and engage the community with the things that are already important to them.
I want to become an orthopedic surgeon, and right now I have an internship at Kaiser, and that's one of the things I want to do in the outside world, is just to help the community. I'm not only changing my life, you know, but I'm also changing other people's lives.
That is that thing of like, I want to get up and work hard to change things for the future, to make things better. I want to interact with my community. How does this small system that we're building out here relate to the larger regional system? Because ultimately that has to happen for the entire city, the entire country, the entire world.
My name is Devin.
My name is Johnny.
My name is Jenny, and I'm a Toro.
Thank you.
first-generation student, and I never really thought that what I was doing was important. Without the help of everybody that's mentored me so far, I don't feel like I would have gotten as far as I have.
For me, that's the best thing about being here. Seeing them achieve things that they never thought they could.
It was a long road to get my bachelor's degree. I took a very untraditional path. I was working, supporting myself. I didn't know what I didn't know. And I made it a point to introduce myself to all of my professors while I was here.
Somebody who's already at this place where you want to be is recognizing something within you. And it gives you the permission to believe in yourself.
Our research focuses on the intersection between psychology, technology, and media, how people's media consumption can affect them. I think it's remarkable that CSUDH has been represented on 60 Minutes on national media. To me, that points to the amazing cutting-edge research that we're doing.
If it wasn't for professors like Dr. Shabir, who had honestly bigger dreams for me than I have for myself, I wouldn't have had one of the most rewarding experiences, not only at CSUDH, but also in my life. The year after I graduated, I got recruited to Facebook, and I thought nobody's ever gonna ask me about the degree. That was the first question they asked.
Ideas can really blossom here. For instance, joining a lab, or having an idea for some program that you wanna start. We really allow those kinds of ideas to grow.
The feeling I had when I was here as a student was that I could do anything. How can I share that experience that I had here with all the other students now?
Mentorship in that sense is incredibly important because I started to believe in my own ability, and that definitely helped me, I suppose, become the person that I really am. For me, success is reaching the point where I can become help to other people, and now I'm heading off to my PhD.
My name is Brie.
My name is Nancy.
My name is Amaranta, and I'm a Toro.
Show with people who share the same goals as you. If you believe it, you can do it.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, welcome back to Terrorism and Extremism. We are now going to begin exploring this concept of the lone wolf terrorist. And in particular, though, what I want you to keep in mind is that every case we're looking at right now comes from the United States. We tend to think that terrorism occurs only in other countries, but every single one of these examples is an example of homegrown terrorism in the United States. So firstly, let me just explain these. We are going to come back to most of the cases that we're talking about, but I just want to summarize them for you right now so that you have a good idea of how this unfolds domestically. Now, first examples we're looking at of lone wolf terrorism are the new terrorism in the United States, beginning with an individual named Umar Farouk Abdul Muttalab. He has gone down in history as the underwear bomber, and again, we'll come back to his case later. But what happened on Christmas Day 2009 is that he attempted to detonate a bomb that was sewn into his garments on an airliner that was flying into Detroit, Michigan. He was inspired by Al-Qaeda. Nidal Malik Hassan was an American soldier, a major in the United States Army, and at Fort Hood, he attacked a cafeteria and killed 13 people and wounded 32 in November of 2009. What is different about this incident is that he was a regular soldier. He was a psychiatrist, and he became radicalized online, and he did this on behalf of Al-Qaeda. In 2013, at the Boston Marathon in April, two individuals, they were brothers actually, Tamerlan and Dzhokhar Tsarnaev, detonated two pressure cooker bombs at the finish line of the Boston Marathon. They killed three people and wounded 264. What's interesting about them is that they constructed these bombs on their own. You will see as we move forward in this course that it is not difficult to obtain information about how to construct similar types of weapons. And we'll come back to their case about how they constructed theirs. In May of 2015 in Garland, Texas, basically a right-wing extremist group called the American Freedom Defense Initiative held a so-called free speech event in which artists were encouraged to draw pictures of the Prophet Muhammad. This is considered to be blasphemy in Islam. And so as they were going to begin displaying these drawings of the Prophet Muhammad, two gunmen drove to this entrance and began taking AK-47 assault rifles out of their car. They were shot dead by off-duty police officers who were guarding there, but they were lucky. That is, I should say, the extremist group, American Freedom Defense Initiative, were lucky in that regard. In December of 2015, in San Bernardino, California, the two individuals on your screen, a married couple inspired by Islamic State, went on a killing spree. The focus of their attack was on the husband's place of work. It was the Inland Regional Center. They killed 14 people and wounded 22. And they actually had a rudimentary explosive device, improvised explosive device, which did not detonate. We'll come back to their case also, because they were completely embedded in the middle class of America. No one would have suspected them. And then Orlando, Florida, in 2016, an individual named Omar Mateen, who claimed Islamic State allegiance, attacked a gay nightclub on Latin Dance Night. It was the Pulse nightclub. He killed 49 people and wounded 53. At that time, it was the worst mass shooting in United States history and the worst terrorist attack since September 11th, 2001. Now, the thing to keep in mind about each one of these incidents is that they are examples of the new terrorism, but they're all carried out domestically in the United States by individuals who were inspired online, on the internet. And so the idea here is that recruitment can occur virtually. One does not have to be in direct contact with a recruiter from a group like Islamic State or Al-Qaeda. All one simply has to do is go online and they can become radicalized. There are many examples of this happening, unfortunately. Which brings us to examples of homegrown lone wolf terrorism in the United States. So understand this particular concept. We've looked at foreign-inspired sources, people who are inspired online by Islamic State or Al-Qaeda, but there are some extremist ideologies in the United States which have resulted in lone wolf terrorism. We tend to call these incidents hate crimes. When we discuss defining terrorism, we will explore what the difference is between a hate crime and terrorism, because an incident can be both a hate crime and terrorism. The examples I'm giving you right now are both hate crimes and terrorism. So firstly, Benjamin Nathaniel Smith was an individual who was a member of the so-called creativity movement. Let me show you the website of the creativity movement, just so you understand what Benjamin Nathaniel Smith was participating in. So let me pull that up now on the screen, online. This is the website for the creativity movement. You can see it's fairly rudimentary, but you can also see their ideology, white racial loyalty without compromise. We will return to them when we talk about the case of the United States, but just understand that basically they believe that the white race is God, that God is within the white race and not within any other race. And you can see this is a neo-Nazi website, very much dedicated to white supremacy. We will come back to this website also. We'll explore it more later, but I just wanted you to understand what creativity is all about and what inspired Benjamin Nathaniel Smith. So, Benjamin Nathaniel Smith, on the 4th of July weekend in 1999, went on a shooting spree. On July 2nd in Rogers Park, six Orthodox Jews were shot. Also on the 2nd of July, an individual named Ricky Birdsong, who was the former Northwestern University basketball coach, was shot dead while walking with two of his children. Then later, in Northbrook, Illinois, an Asian woman and man driving in a car were shot at by a passing car. On the 3rd of July, in Springfield, Illinois, an African-American man was shot while crossing the street, and two more African-American men were shot later crossing the street. In Decatur, an African-American minister or pastor was shot, and later in Urbana, a Taiwanese man was shot, and he was a University of Illinois student. On the 4th of July in Bloomington, Indiana, an Asian University of Indiana graduate student was shot and killed. The police found out who was doing it. They chased Benjamin Nathaniel Smith, and as they chased him, he committed suicide after the chase. Now, he was a member of the creativity movement, and he committed suicide as a symbol of martyrdom. As you'll see when we discuss religious terrorists, they believe that they can be martyred and God will bless them when they die. In 1999, also in August, in the North Valley Jewish Community Center in Los Angeles, Buford O'Neill Furrow, who is a member of an organization called Aryan Nations, a neo-Nazi movement, entered the Jewish Community Center with an AK-47 assault rifle, and he shot the receptionist, he shot a teenage counselor, he shot three children, and fired 70 rounds in 30 seconds. All of the victims were Jewish. He held a Korean woman at gunpoint and stole her car. He drove around and killed a Filipino-American mailman. And then he paid a Los Angeles taxi cab driver $800 to drive him to Las Vegas, where he calmly surrendered to the FBI. And I want you to think about why he was so calm. It was because He believed that what he was doing was absolutely justified. Many terrorists, no matter what they do, arguably sleep very well at night. James Weniker von Braun, in 2009, opened fire at the Holocaust Museum in Washington, D.C. And then Dylan Storm Roof. In June of 2015, he entered a Bible study meeting at an African Methodist Episcopal church in Charleston, South Carolina. Allow me to show you a photograph of Dylan Roof. So Dylan Roof was attempting to start a race war. We will discuss him further when we come back to the American case, but understand that he selected an African-American church. He sat down and discussed the Bible for about 1 hour, and he opened fire and shot and killed 9 people and wounded 13 more. Excuse me, 3 more. He was a racial supremacist. He confessed to the crime. He had an organization or a website that he called The Last Rhodesian. He was trying to start a race war. He thought that these events of what he was doing would begin a racial war in the United States. We will come back to this concept of the racial holy war, or RAHOA, when we discuss neo-Nazis and other right-wing white nationalist extremists in the United States. And then, Cesar Sayoc. Cesar Sayoc sent a number of letter bombs in 2018 through the mail, targeting Democrats, targeting liberals. So he is arguably a fascist type of extremist, but certainly the letter bombs that he sent through the mail, they were inert, but they could have been weaponized. Then lastly, Robert Bowers. We will discuss him again when we discuss the Pittsburgh case, excuse me, the American case, but he entered the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and walked in, shouted, "All Jews must die," and began shooting worshipers on the Sabbath day, on a Saturday. And he was actually part of a chat room online that we will take a look at later. And before he went in, he actually posted a final message in the chat room and then walked into the synagogue and shot to death the Jewish worshipers. Think about what these incidents have in common, in the United States, that is. They are violent. The focus is either on racial supremacy or religious extremism. Some are neo-Nazi beliefs. Others are Islamist beliefs, meaning politicized Islam. And these are carried out either by a single individual or no more than 2 individuals. This is the profile of lone wolf terrorism, and we see that it does occur in the United States from time to time. So the question for you, of course, would be, were these acts of terrorism? We're going to look at a short video now. The short video took place or was brought, was videotaped from August 11th to 12th, 2017, in Charlottesville, Virginia, during a meeting of extreme right-wing activists. It was framed as the Unite the Right rally, and it lasted for 2 days. The people who attended were members of militias and racial supremacist groups, white nationalists, and others. The video you're going to see is a short segment from a longer video that takes place at the University of Virginia campus. It is a march at night. Listen to what they are chanting. That is, these neo-Nazis are chanting. They are chanting, first of all, old slogans from Nazi Germany, but also you'll hear them say something called, or something termed, replacement theory. They are saying, "You will not replace us. Jews will not replace us." That replacement conspiracy theory is international. So just understand that this ideology of white nationalism is not only homegrown American. We saw it in Australia. We've seen it in Germany. We've seen it in Europe. And France. This replacement conspiracy theory is one way in which they communicate with each other. So listen for that chant and understand what white nationalism in the United States looked like in August of 2017 at the University of Virginia campus. So we will go to the video now. What you saw there was an incident that many are hoping will not be repeated. But that is also an example of how the extreme right wing operates, how they communicate themselves with themselves. So let me take you to a particular website that is published by the Southern Poverty Law Center. We will come back to the Southern Poverty Law Center later in the course, because of the kind of research they have. And as you research your papers, your research papers, understand that this is actually a fairly good resource. So the Southern Poverty Law Center is based in Alabama, and they, as you can see, they have resources, and we will come back to this webpage later. They look at hate and extremism, different kinds of rights of different groups, and they have something called Hate Watch. What I'd like to just show you very quickly is a hate map that they publish. This hate map is actually very interesting in the sense that they have every state in the union and various hate groups. And you can see that they, it says in 2018, they tracked 1,020 hate groups across the United States. So we are going to come back to this as a matter of research and perspective, especially when we talk about the United States. What's interesting is, though, we can go, for example, to California and focus on the California situation or profile or environment. And you can see we could access any number of these particular hate groups that are centered in California. You see the Bay Area, Los Angeles area, then the inland areas, Inland Empire, and elsewhere in California. But again, this particular organization, Southern Poverty Law Center, is a good resource for tracking lone wolves because they actually do track individuals and others. So that was a domestic tracking group. We will also come back, as you can see here, to the U.S. Department of State Bureau of Counterterrorism and Countering Violent Extremism. And every year they publish country reports on terrorism. And this is just a table taken from the country reports on terrorism. And you can see it compares total attacks between 2 years in 10 countries with the most terrorist attacks. The United States is not on here. And that is because in these particular countries, you see insurgencies, actual warfare going on domestically inside these various countries. So, of course, we know about Iraq, Afghanistan, and elsewhere, but this is where we see the predominant examples of terrorist incidents, according to the U.S. Department of State. So let us conclude by looking at three cases in point. Looking at criminal skill, terrorism and criminal skill. And we will come back to each of these cases later in the semester. So we'll conclude with these. Firstly, Anders Breivik reflected a relatively low degree of criminal sophistication. He was a Norwegian neo-Nazi and fascist. In July of 2011, he engaged in lone wolf attacks near Oslo, Norway, which killed scores of people. More than 70 people were killed. And he is an individual who we will look at again when we talk about fascism, when we talk about ideological terrorism. So understand that what we're looking at is criminal sophistication, and these are just examples of criminal sophistication. Nextly, we're looking at an individual who has gone down in history as the Unabomber. Theodore Ted Kaczynski exhibited a medium degree of criminal sophistication. He was waging an anarchist war against technology, against digital technology, computer technology, the internet, etc. He went on an 18-year bombing spree. In other words, he sent letter bombs through the postal system to professors and laboratories to attack their research using technologies. He was labeled by the FBI as Unabomb, and he's gone down in history as the Unabomber. If anything, Ted Kaczynski is a modern-day Luddite. Remember the Luddites from the United Kingdom, the machine breakers? He is a modern-day version of an anarchist machine breaker. And then the third person I just want to mention is he was a master terrorist, no question about it. Ramzi Youssef was a dedicated and, if there is such a thing, brilliant terrorist. He had a high degree of criminal sophistication. He was an Islamist, holy warrior. He believed he was spreading the revolution, the Islamist revolution. In February 1993, he bombed the World Trade Center. He was responsible for the first bombing of the World Trade Center. He was attempting, as you'll see later, I will mention this again, he was attempting to tip one of the Twin Towers into another one and destroy the World Trade Center. Clearly, he failed, but Al-Qaeda succeeded in doing that. But just understand that Ramzi Youssef was operational in other countries also before he was captured. He traveled the world as an Islamist terrorist and was very good at what he did, frankly. So if you have any questions, please access the student resources, the open access student resources. If you have any questions for me between now and the next time we meet, please feel free to contact me directly, send me an email, give me a call. So thank you very much. And this will conclude this particular installment of Terrorism and Extremism. My name is Professor Gus Martin, and I'll see you next time.